allowing you to provide response to testimony on House Bill 193. So this legislation has been crafted after hearing the concerns of many Ohioans, healthcare professionals, your client, in particular, whose personal freedoms are being infringed upon as it relates to the ever-increasing pressures and employment demands related to the influence of vaccination. House Bill 193 brings Ohio in line with 13 other states that prohibit the flu vaccine from being a mandatory term of employment. On behalf of a medical professional from Ohio House District 50, who is being adversely impacted by employer-mandated influenza vaccinations, I'm carrying this legislation to empower Ohioans and give them the right to refuse the flu vaccine without placing their jobs in jeopardy. House Bill 193 is not concerning the pro-vaccine, anti-vaccine debate. Rather, this is a bill about professionals maintaining their rights as a patient when making a medical decision, and is specific to only the influenza vaccination. Many people, especially those who are in the business of keeping themselves healthy, do not want to inject strands of flu viruses into their system, recognizing that the repercussions are not necessarily known, nor are the positive intentions guaranteed. When this legislation was originally introduced after the 2014-15 flu season, the efficacy rate was at 23%. And for populations under 2 and over 65 years of age, the efficacy rates are even lower. This flu season, the efficacy rate is only 36% overall, and more Americans are finding themselves in end and outpatient care for influenza-like illnesses this year than in any other year. Voluntarily agreeing to take the flu vaccine, knowing the risk and low efficacy rate, is a right that should be maintained, but to maintain such a vaccine to mandate such a vaccine or face termination of employment is an egregious violation of personal freedom. This legislation is necessary to preserve the autonomy of the individual. I am both pro-business and pro-individual responsibility. I understand that there are substantial pressures on these medical institutions to increase rates of influenza vaccinations in correlation with their federal reimbursements. However, the federal government should not be deciding for the individual what is best for their individual healthcare situation. Many respected professionals have left their place of employment or switched careers to protect themselves from this federal trend after serving for several decades within their profession. Thank you for allowing me to express the concerns that healthcare professionals, like those sitting in the room today, have expressed to me from my district and all across Ohio and the country. They have poured out letters of support for this legislation over the last several years. In fact, we got this bill through committee once and were rerouted to you. So we would love to make our case to you. And I hope you'll provide these individuals with due consideration, just as we provide the gentleman who had been debilitated by the stroke with his consideration just before us. I look forward to answering any questions that you might have to the best of my ability. And if I'm unable to answer any of those questions today, we will ensure to provide you with the appropriate medical professionals with the expertise to do so.
Thank you for your testimony, Representative Butler.
Yes, Madam Chair, thanks for your testimony. Wondering, given that a flu vaccine is a medical procedure, it's more of a legal question maybe, but if something goes wrong or is an adverse event, then who takes the responsibility?
Sure, Chair Gowron, Representative Butler. So unfortunately, 2 years before I was born, the federal government stripped away the rights of individuals to actually directly sue the person or the companies that would be most likely liable for an adverse impact, injury, or death. And the citizens of the United States are held liable for any injury that is induced upon a person who is vaccine injured in the state of Ohio or in the nation. In fact, we've paid out, $3.7 billion worth of injuries that are funded by taxpayers. And unfortunately, none of that liability goes back on the producer or manufacturer of the actual content that injured the individual.
In terms of the actual mandate of the flu vaccine in different places of employment, but especially in healthcare institutions, could you give a history of where that originated and why?
Sure. Chair Gowron, Representative Butler. So as you know, this has not always been the trend. This has not always been the case. In fact, there are many medical employees in this room who have chosen to opt out of the flu vaccine through the entirety of their career, many of which have lost their jobs in the state of Ohio and have advocated for this piece of legislation because of that. The trend actually came down from the federal government, not necessarily legislatively, but through Healthy People 2020. And there were actually folks who sat on the board that actually sell and manufacture vaccines. So this was suggested, it was a mere suggestion, it was not legislated.
Representative Sykes.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Representative, for coming forth today. This is a very interesting conversation for me. As you know, I'm trained in public health, and vaccinations are, you know, one of the things that public health takes a lack of victory for in all types of settings and diseases and preventing things such as polio and even human papillomavirus, which is really quite incredible. It just seems it's really working at my core. You know, I know I'm a legislator and a lawyer, but my first love truly is public health. To have this conversation in the middle of the flu season, where people are dying, children are dying, and we're saying, you know, one of the most proactive tools that we have against the flu, you're suggesting that we should eliminate in some capacity. You know, Health 2020, and I'm going to try not to editorialize too much because obviously there should be a question here, is a wonderful tool by a lot of very smart people who do use data and empirical evidence in order to make their recommendations. It is the levels of people and process to make those recommendations, and that's merely just a suggestion that gets accepted. It's absolutely and patently false, and to suggest that it's false as well. But when I've been discussing this bill, and I have three hospital systems at home, everyone has shared with me that there are several procedures by which they make accommodations for people who don't want to take the flu vaccine. And they offer them to people, and they don't, their goal is not to fire people. They've hired them, and there's obviously some talent there. They like them, they think they're going to be a benefit to the community. So it seems as though, and one of my favorite colleagues on your side of the aisle always says this looks like a solution looking for a problem. There doesn't seem to be the widespread problem as you infer to today. So, you know, again, maybe there's a question in there somewhere, but you know, I guess what I can say is there any widespread study about how many people are actually being fired or demoted because they're refusing a flu vaccine, and whether or not it's just related to the healthcare field, or is this being expanded into other businesses or industries?
Chair Yoder and Representative Sykes, I will attempt to answer your question, which I think is at the very end. Obviously, this legislation is not based off of anecdotal evidence, although there have been cases, I think, that are noteworthy. I mean, St. Vincent Hospital, just next door in Pennsylvania, has had to reinstate their employees for infringing on personal rights and autonomy. I mean, this is a civil issue that is very concerning about people's personal autonomy, their personal freedoms. It is not a pro or anti-vaccine discussion. I made that very clear initially in my legislation. This has everything to do with patients' rights, which your side of the aisle advocates for very clearly and effectively on a regular basis. So I would just reiterate that it's not anecdotal. However, there are hundreds and thousands, actually thousands of people that have written letters expressing the type of perverse actions taken by their employment against them in their work environment in the state of Ohio based off of their desire to decline the influenza vaccine. And although they have used completely rational basis for those declining of that specific vaccine, even egg allergens and known and documented other medical professionals, they have not received the liberty that you're suggesting exists. And although your hospital systems may be more friendly or may have masking requirements or other suggestive routes for people to be able to decline the flu vaccine, that is not the case across the entire state of Ohio. So because things are good in Summit County, doesn't mean they're good in all 88 counties, and that's why this legislation is necessary to protect the rights of individuals. And I would go further to say, we have a list here of the vaccine rates and the star rating and quality performance of the hospital. guard yourself, to wash hands, hygiene efforts. And just because a lot of intelligent people made a decision that this should be a recommendation, it does not strip away the individual liberty of a person to educate themselves about the hundreds of strands of flu that are acquired within a flu season and the few strains of flu that may be matched up on a particular flu vaccine. That doesn't strip away their right to educate themselves on what might be coming their way and then to take the proper precautions. We do not have long-term studies of the impacts of taking a flu vaccine on a compounding annual basis. And so I would think from somebody who is well-versed and respects public health, we would want to look long-term at that specific type of data as well and understand what it actually means to have these types of things injected into our bodies on an annual basis and what that means long-term. But we do not have that information at the CDC.
Thank you, and thank you for that answer. But still, you didn't provide any source of evidence that this is a widespread. You told me, you just said that there are thousands of people. I would be more than happy to see what that looks like in a study that's been published in a reputable scientific journal or in a article of some sort. And even if you just have letters, that's fine too. But right now, you're telling me anecdotal stories, and I'm not saying that they're not true. I'm not discounting anyone's personal or employment issues, because I'm confident there's a will, there's a way. People find all types of opportunities to do things to other folks that are strange. And I would appreciate if you did not debate the efficacy of influenza without detailed information, because although you said you were not going to, you did mention many things. And so again, I like science, I'm in science, I like to follow that. I know it is not perfect, but if you could just provide something that's a little bit more credible, that would be very helpful for me in deciding and debating this. Thank you.
Chairwoman, Representative Sykes, I'm more than thrilled to provide you with the years of study that I and many people in this room have done to come to this point of the need in the legislation. More than glad to do that.
Thank you, Representative Mayer.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Representative Mayer, thank you so much for bringing this to our attention. One of the questions I have is trying to get a lay of the land of what the current law is. And from different proponents and opponents that have even debated this in the public square, it's my understanding that hypothetically, if a nurse is told by her personal primary physician that it is not in your best interest to have a flu shot or any shot, that it's not in your personal best interest, their primary physician is saying, do not take this. And we have a situation in Michigan, Ohio, where we have a hospital or a government-run hospital that says you have to inject something to your body, even though your primary physician says it's not in your best health interest or you lose your job. Is that currently the lay of the land in Ohio, as you know?
Representative Gavron, Chairwoman Gavron and Representative Marin, your personal care provider should trump your health circumstance, but it doesn't protect your employment. So certainly your personal care provider, your personal physician, knows your life history, knows what you can and cannot have into your body that might potentially be debilitating or possibly deadly. And they make suggestions based off of your health record. But that is not necessarily going to hold up to the scrutiny of your employer. In fact, a constituent of mine reached out after I started working on this bill, again, an A allergen, well documented her entire life. She hadn't taken any vaccines to date. She worked as a nurse and she also volunteered at a local pregnancy support center. Her medical exemption was declined, even though she had a physician's statement saying that she could not take this vaccine because it would be obviously and visibly debilitating to her. So she actually had to litigate to protect her job against her physician's recommendations for her to have that flu vaccine because the pressure was so substantial on the hospital system to get to that 90% vaccination.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My next question is, you briefly touched on your testimony, the tie-in between federal money and federal reimbursements based on employees' vaccination rate. Can you expand on that, of how hospitals get more money potentially or less money based on ways to receive the vaccination?
Sure. Chairwoman McGovern, Representative Merritt, so there is a 2% reduction in your Medicare reimbursement from the federal government if you do not reach a 90% vaccination threshold.
Madam Chairman, and when did that policy, when did that come into place?
I want to say it was 2012, but I could be a little blurry on the numbers. I've got a lot of documents rolling.
And since 2012, have you seen a more higher enforcement of hospitals trying to get their employees vaccinated?
Chairwoman and Representative, yeah, absolutely. So the trend has been escalating to get higher levels of vaccination as it relates to influenza in particular. And again, like I said, in Maine, even with the vaccination rate, it's not correlating to a lower quality rating of the hospital. And you know, some that have a 77% vaccination rate have a 4-star rating, and some that have, you know, a 95% have a 4-star, some that have much lower, getting down into 60 still have 4-star. So there's not a direct correlation between that. But yes, there is a trend to get to those numbers.
May I ask one question?
Yes.
We're busy today. One other area of interest when you start talking about hospitals is collective bargaining and unions. Do you have any, has there been any discussion or have we seen any unions collectively bargain to try to protect their employees or insert in a collective bargaining agreement that no employee will be forced to have a vaccine? Is that any collective bargaining agreement?
Representative Gabbard, or Chairwoman Gabbard, Representative Merritt. So I don't have the specific contractual agreements, or I apologize for losing my voice, but interestingly enough, I put together data points a while back because it just shows that this bill should be really an all across the board pro Ohio piece of legislation. The following groups oppose mandatory influenza vaccinations, VOIP exemptions. These are statements that have been extracted from their own websites. The American Medical Association, Service Employees International Union, SEIU, which has over a million members, Americans of Association of American Physicians and Surgeons, American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, American Federation of Teachers, Association of Flight Attendants, Communications Workers of America, the Coalition of Kaiser Permanente Unions, United Steel, Paper and Forestry, Rubber, Manufacturing, Energy, Allied Industrial Service Workers International Union. These are just some examples of people that have very serious concerns about vaccine efficacy and whether it should be mandated as a term of employment and protecting the employee's rights in those circumstances. And in fact, OSHA stated that it believes there is insufficient scientific evidence for the federal government to promote mandatory influenza vaccination programs that do not have an option for the healthcare provider to decline for medical, religious, and or philosophical reasons. So it is interesting because this hits a broad stroke of people. I don't have the internal contractual agreements. These are just the broad position statements that are pulled directly from their websites.
Representative Kent.
Thank you so much, Chairwoman. Thank you so much for coming in with this. I'm just going to be honest. I'm one of those that would not want to get this flu vaccine shot, so I'm just going to be upfront about that. And I'm probably came to that because I remember, you know, having acne, and I remember having adult acne, and I know this is not, you know, probably related to a flu vaccine, but I just remember having that, and I remember the doctor saying that you could not be pregnant if you decided to take this acne medicine. I already had my child, but that's all they said was that you couldn't be pregnant. Later on, the Accutane, it said that it could cause deformity in your children, it could cause you to have suicidal thoughts, and I was just blown away that I took this medication for acne. So that's probably been one of my pushbacks from feeling that someone will make me take something that maybe later on. So my question then surrounds what you had said about, I don't know where this was, but you were saying that they had to give them back their jobs.
Yes.
After they did that. Could you talk a little bit about that case and why it was decided that, in what state that was, and why it was decided that they had to give them back their jobs, and that did that include back pay and losses, a cost?
Yes, so
Representative Kent. Thank you. I respect your personal choice to make a decision about what is best for your medical situation, and also your intuitiveness to, you know to balance that. I mean, my mother had a similar experience where she had terrible nausea her entire pregnancy, and they always suggested a specific drug, and she went to the library before you could research everything on your smartphone, and she spent hours and hours and hours studying, and she found out, based off of her own personal desire to gather that information, that that particular drug that had been recommended to her was a high likelihood of causing deformities, but that was not told to her by her medical professional, so she had to make that decision, just as you made the decision. As it relates to the case in Erie, Pennsylvania, I am more than happy to get the information surrounding that case. It is very recent. It was at St. Vincent Hospital. They originally terminated employees for wishing to abstain from receiving that medical procedure, the invasive medical procedure through an influenza vaccine, and were found to be in the wrong constitutionally, and they now have to afford back pay over hundreds of thousands of dollars to several employees who were stripped of their employment, and also offer them the opportunity to have their job back when those jobs become available. So yes, this is actually an employment issue as much as it is a personal economy issue.
Thank you so much, Representative, and thank you for that. Did they have, in Pennsylvania, did they have any kind of, have their legislators been talking about protection prior to that law? Do you know anything about what their legislation was doing prior to that lawsuit?
Chairwoman and Representative Kent, my assumption is that there was zero protection in state law for them, but they were protected through their civil liberties, ultimately when it was tried in the courts.
Thank you. And I think the core of this argument is, what's the rationale for depriving employees of their liberty on whether or not they can decide to take a vaccine or not? Of course, anything you put in your body is a potential for adverse events. But the reason that you might do it is, as you'd say, well, if we get enough herd immunity, if 90% of the people at a healthcare facility are vaccinated, then that will have some great health results for the patients. And so I was wondering if you were aware, it's actually a study that I'm aware of the, and actually it was well done and with quite a bit of study, but that said that 50% or higher herd immunity in a hospital versus 90% herd immunity in a hospital had no difference. Were you aware of that study, and what are the implications of that finding on whether or not you should go ahead and deprive employees of their liberty?
Chairwoman Gavin, Representative Butler, I'm not particularly aware of that right out of the gate, but I'm sure there are many people in this room that are highly versed and well educated on that particular study. Based off of that,